Can you guess what this part is or what it's for? Can you identify the features that were challenging to make or how we worked with our client to overcome those challenges? Stay tuned to find out those answers along with some engineering tips and tricks in this plastic injection molding video case study. Specialized applications usually require specialized manufacturing solutions. This fluid reservoir, for example, was very carefully engineered to monitor nutrient intake to provide the ideal liquid volume for feeding livestock. So clearly, an off-the-shelf component just wouldn't do. In order to fulfill the customer's specifications, we therefore needed to apply our expertise in mold tool design optimization to create a product that outperformed their expectations and which continues to provide reliable service in the field. As with every project, it's most important to first establish a clear line of open communication between ourselves and the client. We always need to know what the product is meant to do and in what environment. This information is essential if we want to perform a design review that helps them achieve their goals in the most efficient way possible. This might mean faster production, lower cost, less material waste, or some combination of these. Plastic injection molding projects are especially demanding in this regard because we have to consider not just the finished product, but also the design of the mold tool that we'll use to make it. And sometimes the design of the two are in conflict and therefore require some compromises to both. We begin by looking at what type of thermoplastic resin is going to be used. Many times our clients are unsure about what material they want, or else they may change resins midway through a project, not realizing just how consequential that is. What difference does the type of resin make to the mold tool design? Every type of resin has unique mechanical and chemical properties, and these interact with the tool in complex ways. For example, some resins are stickier than others. That is, they cling to the tool after cooling, and so larger draft angles are needed to allow for mold release. That's just one of many considerations. So remember to always design for the material. Don't try to force the material to fit the design. In this case, the material was Ultrasan P3010, a chemically stable plastic that resists high heat steam sterilization. Knowing this helped us to then calculate the right melt flow rate, melt temperature, proper moisture content, and all the other parameters needed to establish consistency. When molding a complex shape like this, it really helps to use advanced Moldflow software from Autodesk. This is a sophisticated software simulation tool that gives us valuable insights that we use to correct draft angles, avoid sink marks, improve cooling circuit design, and much more. After running a Moldflow simulation, we uncovered the following concerns. First, we have these areas in red and yellow, with little or no draft angle. Without some form of modification, it would be impossible to remove the part from the mold at this spot without scraping against the tool wall and probably destroying the part. The only way to mold features like these is to design separate inserts that withdraw from the faces at right angles after molding. Other areas, indicated in blue, had sufficient draft to allow for part release in the line of draw or the direction of tool opening. Speaking of inserts, we had to design a couple more. In addition to this face, there's also the long feed tube here that needs an insert. In addition, you can see how challenging it is to get cooling circuits into this area without interfering with the gate and runner system for the resin or the injector pins. Moldflow also identified potential sink marks, which you can see here. This sink occurs right where these two wall sections meet on the other side. Sink is caused because the extra mass here cools and shrinks slower, pulling the adjacent side in. Let's consider the surface finish. As you can see, most of this part has a smooth, glossy surface, which is measured to SPI A2. To get that surface, we have to polish the cavity of the mold tool. However, notice this recessed area with a matte texture. To produce that, we used chemical photo etching. Matte textures like these make it easier to see the manufacturing date, which is stamped in this window during each day's production run. By the way, the use of date stamps helps to track a product's life cycle and reminds the client when it's time to replace a part if it's time sensitive. With this complex shape, the parting line, or where the mold separates, is not a single plane, but rather consists of steps, angles, and curves that follow the contours of several different features. We designed shutoff angles where these faces meet. These angles ensure good closure of the mold tool and help to prolong the tool life. Our next step was to lay out the circuits for the cooling channels. It's important to note that coolant is used not just to solidify the molten resin, but to evenly distribute heat throughout the part. Uniform heating and cooling is one of the most important ways to avoid molding defects. The blue line is the gate and runner system directing resin into the cavity. The red line is the coolant channel. Notice that internal baffles and U-joints were used to force the coolant in a return circuit. Also, independent cooling circuits were designed for each insert, making this a little more complicated. Note also that we arranged the circuits so that they didn't interfere with the placement of the ejector pins that run perpendicular to the coolant lines. Ejector pins push the part off the core after molding, but they leave a corresponding mark on the part's surface. Care should be taken to place pins in a balanced arrangement to ensure even distribution of force to avoid damaging the part or the pins themselves. Pins need to be placed strategically around the gate where sufficient ejection pressure is needed to clear the gate in the event of a partial injection or a short shot. Gate placement and type are also important considerations, and there are many to choose from. Usually, gates are placed as close as possible to the thickest section of the part. More importantly, the gate location must ensure that all features fill evenly and quickly within the limited cycle time. And that can be very challenging indeed and take a lot of fine-tuning to balance out all of the forces involved. Finally, after all the design considerations, we arrived at a mold tool that looks like this. Many components have to work together in a complex orchestration to create a finished product that fulfills the customer's design intent. We hope that you found this video case study to be interesting and informative. If you'd like to see more like this, please ring the bell, give us a like, and consider subscribing. We'd be happy to answer any comments you may have in the comments section below, and we hope you'll join us for our next video case study.